Last Sunday we talked about radical love, and this is the second part of this radical love, and this one's the radical love of Jesus Christ. And now we will be talking about the cross through the eyes of the Jews and the Romans. Now let me ask you this, how many of you here you have crosses at home? You have your personal crucifix at home? One, two, several of you, right? We have crosses. How many of you you have your necklace, cross, a necklace? Yeah, one, two, several of you. And how about anklet, you know, for the cross? You know, and you do like this, you can see the cross. How about tattoo on your body? A cross. Cross tattoo. How about earring? Cross. We have one. How about nose ring? Nose rings. Okay. Now, let me ask you this. Why do you have a cross? What's the purpose of the cross? Why did you buy the cross? Why do you have to have that cross? Why do you have to be proud of the cross and flaunt the cross? What do you think? What is that?
It's a symbol of Jesus' love.
Symbol of love. Right. But let me tell you this. The cross actually is a symbol, or was a symbol, of horror. The cross was a symbol of shame. The cross was a symbol of failure. The cross was a symbol of pain. The cross was a symbol of curse. The cross was a symbol of defeat. But now, the cross, we put the cross with a different meaning, right? And that's why we make the cross as an accessory. Even some cars, we have cars that has crosses on them. Now, to us, we see the cross in a different light, because we are now living in the 21st century. But for us to better understand the cross, we have to go back to the first century. It's a long, long travel from 21st century to the first century during the time of Jesus, actually even before the time of Jesus. So now we are going to look at the cross as the eyes of the Jewish people and of the Roman people during the time of Jesus. And let me take off with this very straightforward verse that says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 23, we preach Christ crucified, which is a stumbling block to the Jewish people. They don't like it. The Jewish people get stumbled. That means they trip on it. They don't like it. They won't believe it. And foolishness to the Gentiles. Anybody who is not a Jew is a Gentile. That includes the Greek, the Romans, all of us are Gentiles. But during that time, for the Jew, for the Greek philosophers and for the Roman citizens, their cross was foolishness. For them, it's like, how are we going to believe in Jesus Christ who was crucified on the cross? And for the Jewish people, it said, how are we going to believe in Jesus that he's the Messiah and went to the Lord of God if he was crucified on the cross? Now, why are they asking that? First, let's take a look on the cross through the eyes of the Jewish people. To the Jewish people, the cross has two symbols. The first symbol is the cross was a symbol of defeat. The first symbol was that the cross was a symbol of defeat. Now, we have to go back. As we go back to the time of Jesus Christ, we have to go back a little bit, maybe 100 years before Jesus Christ was born. All right? Israel was invaded by Rome. The Roman citizens, especially the Roman soldiers, were very, very barbaric and sadistic. And the Empire of Rome, the Caesar of Rome, the President of Rome, he hated every time there's a revolution, there's a rebellion against Rome. Every time the invaded country would rebel against Rome, something is going to happen. Something must happen. In 103 BC, which is 103 years before the birth of Jesus Christ, there was this guy named Alexander Janus in 103 BC, and he was opposed by the Pharisees, the Jewish people, by the religious leaders of the Jews. They're called the Pharisees. And in one day, he crucified 800 people, 800 religious leaders in one day. 20 years after that, there was another guy during the time of Augustus. His name was Varus. He came in with his armies in Jerusalem and crucified 2,000 Jews. So every time there's a revolution against Rome, Rome would come back and crucify the leaders of the revolution. And for them, for the Israelite people, for the Jewish people, they said, the cross is a stumbling block to us because that reminds us that we are not free. The cross would remind us that we are defeated. We are a failed nation, and our leaders has been failing, has been failing, has been failing. And that is why every time somebody would make a revolution against Rome during the time of Jesus Christ, or before the time of Jesus Christ, somebody would lead a revolution, the Roman people would say, remember the cross. Remember the cross. Meaning that basically it was a threat. Telling the Jewish people, telling the Israelite people, saying, hey dude, remember the 2,000 people that was crucified on the cross, and before that there were 8,000 people, and then some several hundreds of people have been crucified on the cross. Remember the cross. Before you would think of any rebellion against Rome, remember the cross. And think twice. Think about it. So that cross has been a symbol of fear, a symbol of defeat, a symbol of failure to the Jewish people. Now the second symbol to the Jewish people is this. The cross was a symbol of curse. Now in the Mosaic law, during the time of Moses, the law of Moses in the Old Testament, there's this what it said in Deuteronomy 21 verse 23. Anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. In Filipino, right? The cross was made out of tree. Jesus Christ was crucified on a tree. He was cursed. And then Paul said in Galatians chapter 3 verse 13, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. So basically Paul was just repeating what Moses said in Deuteronomy. Anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. Paul said, curses everyone who is hung on a tree. Moses said, anyone who is hung on a tree is under God's curse. So to the Jewish people, they would say, how would I believe that Jesus is the Messiah? Now the word Messiah means the anointed one of God. And they would say, well, how would I believe that Jesus Christ was the anointed one of God if he was cursed by God himself? He could not be the Messiah. That's why it was a stumbling block to them. For them, they could not believe. That is why if you are going to present Jesus Christ to the Jewish people and you are going to tell them about the cross, they would say, it won't happen. It's not going to happen. Because how could a Messiah, the anointed one of God, be cursed? But we have to remember that Jesus Christ was cursed to take the curse away from us because we have been cursed already. And Jesus Christ was hanging on a tree, hanging on a cross to be cursed, to take away the curse from us. Now, that's on the eyes of the Jewish people. Let's take a look through the eyes of the Romans. The first one is, the cross to the Romans was very offensive. They don't want to talk about it. In fact, they said that the cross is only for the subhumans. You know the word subhuman? They're not really human. They are like a little higher than animals, close to being human. Okay. And do you know who they refer as subhumans? Anybody who is not a Roman citizen are subhumans. So meaning that we are subhumans, the Jewish people are subhumans, the Greeks are subhumans, everybody is subhumans except for the Roman citizen. And so for them, it was so offensive that even the historians, they don't want to talk about it. They don't want to write about it. There were some little detailed stops writing about the crucifixion. In fact, it was the gospel that says they crucified him. I mean, the gospel wrote more about crucifixion than the Roman philosophers and Roman historians. And one Roman historian, his name was Cicero. He was a brilliant historian. And this is what he said. I don't want to talk. I don't want to write more about crucifixion because it's so offensive. And no Roman citizen should be crucified because crucifixion is only for subhumans. Imagine that. It's so offensive. They don't want to talk about it. Even in casual conversation, it's so taboo. Right? Like for us, there are some areas, there are some issues that we don't want to talk about in our family because it's taboo. And to them, the talk about the cross was taboo. So it was so offensive to them. Second is, the cross is shameful. It's not only offensive, it's also shameful. Why is it so shameful? Now this is what they do. This is what the Roman people would do. The Roman armies, soldiers would do. A person who's willing to be crucified, they have to be stripped naked. The purpose of the cross, one of the purposes of the cross is to shame the victim. And part of that is, they have to be stripped naked. Now imagine Jesus hanging on the cross naked. On the pictures that we see, on the paintings and the crosses that we see, Jesus was wearing a girdle. In reality, he was not wearing anything. That is part of the shame. That is part of the shame. Right? And the shame did not end with their life either. Once dead, the victim would not be buried. The families would not come and claim the victim because of the shame. What are they going to do with the body? They would just let the body hanging on the cross be eaten by worms, by insects, by vultures, by birds, by animals. To shame the enemies, to shame the people, and to shame the victim. So the crucifixion is designed to shame its victims. See? The cross was not a symbol of life, it was a symbol of shame. Even to the Romans who perfected crucifixion found it to be utterly shameful. In fact, it was not legal to crucify a Roman citizen, except for cases of high treason. And that is why every time you feel embarrassed or ashamed or scared to share the gospel, you have to think about this. Jesus was hanging on the cross, naked. He was shamed. And do you know why? Another thing on that is they have to walk. If you are the victim of crucifixion, you have to carry your cross and you have to walk on main streets so that people could see you. And they will hang you. The cross will be put up on places, on high places, on major roads where people could see you even when you are dead and dying. And that is why, if you feel embarrassed, if you feel ashamed of sharing the gospel, of sharing Jesus Christ to other people, I like this what the writer of Hebrews said, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. He said, every time you feel embarrassed or ashamed to share Jesus Christ to others, to talk about Jesus Christ to others, he said, fix your eyes on Jesus. Remember the cross. Remember the cross. Fix your eyes on Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame. Jesus took the shame upon himself. And there's nothing to be embarrassed about. Jesus would have took it upon himself. So remember the cross. Every time somebody would ask you about your faith, don't be embarrassed about your faith. Don't be embarrassed to share about your faith in Jesus Christ. Don't be ashamed of Jesus Christ. Okay? Now, the third one, so the first one to the Romans was offensive. The second one, the cross is shameful. And the third one, the cross is unbearably painful. It is very, very painful. Now, the crucifixion is one of the most sadistic forms of torture that has been invented by men. It was invented actually by the Persians. It was used by the Egyptians, by the Indians. And then the art of pain was perfected by the Romans. That's how it was. The Romans turned this particular cruel form of execution into an art form of pain. Now, crucifixion does not damage any major organs. It's not going to damage your heart, it's not going to damage your lungs, it's not going to damage your liver, it's not going to damage your kidney. Or does it cause severe amount of blood loss? The benefit of this particular form of punishment is that the person could survive for several days. Some people hanging the cross, they could last for 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. Maybe some other people could last for 6 days. And there is something that happened to the body during the crucifixion, and the Romans understood this better than most. The first one that I want to show you. In the Bible, you will see that Jesus was flogged. Flogging for the Jewish people is 40 minus 9. Okay, flogging is you use a rod, maybe 3 to 6 feet of rod, and then you hit the victim. Boom. 40 minus 9 is 39. Why is it 40 minus 9? Why is it 39? Because the flogger is not allowed to do it more than 40. If the flogger will go to 41, then the flogger will be flogged himself. So that's how it works. So it's always 40 minus 9 to make sure that you are not going to go over 40. Now, the difference between the Jewish flog and the flogging and the Roman flogging is this: the rod. Okay? Now again, to the Jewish people, they would use a stick, a rod. To the Romans, it's different. The stick is maybe 3 feet long, and then there is just another 3 to 6 feet long of string, leather string, and there are 9 of them. Okay? Now, in between that, there are some bolts and nuts, all right, rods in between the string. So here's the rod, and then there's the first batch of rods, okay, of strings, of bolts, right? And then after that are blades and shards of nails and metals, okay? So which means that the string itself was probably this long, okay? And then here's the some bolts and nuts, and then the shards and nails and blades and metals, right? And this is what they would do. They would make the victim kneel down on a pole, and then they would hit, right? They would hit the victim, boom. The first is the bolts, right? Hitting your ribs, okay, or back. That would cause concussion. That's the first one that would hit, boom. The second thing that would hit is the nails. The nails would wrap around, the string would wrap around your body and would stick on your skin, and here's the best part according to the Roman barbarians. The pulling out. Right? So they would hit, the string would wrap around your body, boom! Folks. The body of Jesus was unrecognizable. His skin was torn apart. According to the study, 6 out of 10 died before they would be crucified, just due to the flogging itself. And no wonder Jesus was not able to carry the crossbar on the way to crucifixion. He was just so physically wiped out. It's not once, 39 times. The more pain, the more fun for the Roman soldiers. The more groanings, the more shouting and screaming for the Roman soldiers. They're happy about it. The second one is, you could barely see that one, but that is the crown. The leader of the group would always receive a crown. Okay? And this is the crown of thorns. Now these are long thorns, okay? Very long thorns. It's a very thorny plant, right? And they would wrap it around, and they would not put it on you gently. They did not put it on Jesus gently. They have to get the thorny crown and press it hard on Jesus' head, not enough to make sure that it's not going to fall off. They have to use a hammer to make sure that every thorn would pierce into the skull and be fastened. That's how much Jesus endured. The third one is not so bad. It's the spit. Jesus, the spit of Jesus. It will not break your body, but the purpose of the spit is to break your spirit, saying you are nothing. And they mocked Jesus and said, see, you claim to be the king of the Jews? You claim to be powerful? You did miracles? Show us your miracle. And they spit on Jesus. Right? They make fun of Jesus. The fourth is the crossbar. The crossbar is 125 pounds. Now, Jesus barely carried the crossbar upright. It was hard for him. So somebody took it from him. But imagine this. Okay? Just imagine the crossbar. Carrying the crossbar in your skin has been all cut off. You could see, people could see your ribs already in the back, the bones in your back already, right? And even your spine, you could see the spine. And that's, and they have to walk from the Praetorium to the vault of them, right? Calvary, the place called Skull, where he was nailed to the cross. And then the next one is the nailing of the hands. Here's the thing. The nail, I don't know if it was China made, but we know that the alabaster perfume, the nard, was China made, right? We talked about that last week. But it's 7 inches long. Right? Now, according to medical science and to the studies, there are two ways to nail a person on the cross. The first one is, and this is the popular one that we know of, that Jesus was nailed with a palm of his hand, right? Right here, right? Now, according to some experts, they said our palm could only carry 80 pounds. So it could not carry the whole weight of the person, right? To the Romans, when they say, to the Greeks and to the Romans and the Jews, Jewish people, whenever they say hands, they're not only referring to this. From here to the elbow are part of your hands. This is hand, right? And so they believe that Jesus was not nailed using the palm, on his palm, but right here. Okay? If you could feel it, okay, there's bone, right? Two bones here, in between, right? And that would carry a person's body weight. Okay? The thing about this is the searing pain. It's very, very painful that you could feel it all over your body. That's about the nail. The next one is the crucifixion itself. Okay, this is how they do it on the crucifixion. So he was nailed, right? And he was nailed on his feet as well. Now there is this, what they call it, the stepper. What is the purpose of the stepper? The purpose of the stepper is so that they can push themselves up. Okay? So they're being nailed so they can pull themselves. As they pull themselves, they have to push themselves up so that they can breathe. That's how they are going to breathe, the victim. And that is why, when it's about 6 o'clock, about noon, they have to make sure, because it was Passover and nobody should be there during the Passover time, they have to break the legs before the Passover time. They have to break the legs of the victim. But Jesus was dead when before that, right? This is how they do it. So as you push, you breathe in, then breathe out. Breathe in, breathe out. Breathe in. That's why some people will stay longer. They can survive longer. The two thieves, Okay, the criminals right next to Jesus, their legs were broken. Why? So that they could not breathe and they could not push themselves anymore. The purpose of that is to suffocate you. The victim of crucifixion dies by suffocation. And then, in addition to the pain of the crucifixion, the labored breathing, a victim would commonly have insects burrow into their wounds. Birds and vultures were drawn to the bodies, particularly the moisture of the eyeballs, and would actually eat the victim off the cross. There is nothing glamorous about the cross. The cross is not some glorious, wonderful thing. The cross is a disgusting, vile, ruthless way to end someone's life. And this is what we celebrate. The cross. The effects of crucifixion in the body of Abraham, Jesus felt them all. Jesus felt every tiny bit of it. Every last in the Roman cap of nine tails, every agonizing breath it took Jesus his final hour to the cross to Christ. Do you see how strange it is that the cross is the focal point of our faith? How odd it is to focus on such a terrible thing, yet we boast in the cross. We take pride in it, for in the cross our sins are covered. Amen. In the cross our transgressions are wiped away. In the cross, through the blood of Jesus Christ, our sins have been forgiven. Imagine this, when Jesus was hanging on the cross, naked, blooded. He was trying to breathe, pushing himself up with his legs, pulling himself up with his arm, his hand, scratching the wounds on his back, on the rugged tree, on the beam. He's taking his breath, thinking about us, thinking about it. He could have said, "I'm done here." But he said, "No, I am thinking about you, thinking about each one of us." Galatians chapter 6, verse 14, Paul said, "May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." Everything. He said, "May I never boast except on the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ." I'm just going to talk about the cross, and I'm going to boast about the cross, and I'm going to take pride of the cross, because on that cross, my sins have been forgiven. Yeah? On that cross, I can go to heaven. On that cross, my relationship with God the Father has been restored. On that cross, I have eternal life. Amen? How are we going to respond to this? First, don't let the cross pass by you without making a decision. The sacrifice of Jesus Christ would be a loss, would be in vain. If you would just look at it and say, "Wow, so that is how he died, that is how Jesus Christ suffered," and then you're not going to make a decision to say, "Lord, you suffered, you sacrificed yourself. Now I am going to make you as my Lord and Savior. I've seen how you suffered. It was a terrible death. Now, Lord, today I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to make a decision to make you as my Lord and Savior." Let me tell you, you don't have all the time in the world, and your time is just soon passed without even you knowing. You've got to make a decision. If you haven't made a decision yet, if you haven't crossed the bar yet of committing yourself to Jesus Christ, asking for his forgiveness, and asking to be the Lord and Master of your life, this is now the time. Otherwise, Jesus' sacrifice on the cross for you would be in vain, would be nothing. Now, if you have made that decision already, there's another decision that you have to make. You have to die for Jesus. You have to die for Jesus by living for Him. Okay? In Matthew chapter 10, verse 38, it says, anyone who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Anyone who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. And Jesus is not saying that you have to die the same way He died. Right? What He was saying is our cross, our personal thing, our heart, our minds. And let me put this into perspective. The cross is about so much more than death. What Jesus is asking you is this. Are you willing to forsake everything else in life for Jesus? Are you willing to be mocked in school, at work, because of your faith? Are you willing to be poked fun by your family, by your friends, by your peers, because of your belief? Are you willing to be persecuted and mistreated by others for Jesus Christ? Jesus is not only asking you to be willing to die for Him. He's asking you first to be willing to live for Him. Every day of your life, you have to live for Jesus. Because you cannot die for Jesus if you are not going to live for Jesus. You have to forsake it all. And if you're not willing to live and to die for Jesus, then Jesus said, you're not worthy of me. And that's a rejection point there. If you're not willing to take up your cross, if you're not willing to die for me, if you're not willing to live for me, then you're not worthy of me. The bottom line is this. What once a symbol of curse, of shame, of failure, of pain, of defeat, is now a symbol of triumph, redemption, and victory. That's what we have. That's why you have crosses. Not that we use the cross for anything else, but that cross would remind us that Jesus Christ suffered the shame, suffered the pain for you and me. Every time you see a cross, that would remind you that your Savior died for you. He could have said no. As we studied the prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, how many times did Jesus pray? How many times? He prayed 3 times. He said, Father, please, please, if possible, I don't want to go through this. I don't want to die on the cross. I don't want to be crucified. Father, I can't, not that I can, but please, if it is your will, if it's okay with you, can we just skip this part? He prayed this 3 times to the point that his sweat was like blood. How many times was he denied? The Father denied him 3 times. Every time he would pray, Dad, can we just skip this part? The Father said no. Dad, if it is okay, can you just please let me pass this? I don't want to suffer on the cross. It's so humiliating, it's so painful. He could see it because it was a common thing during his time to see somebody being crucified on the cross. The Father said no. The third time he went to the Father again, praying, Father, please, please, please. And this is when his sweat turned to blood. Please, can I just skip the crucifixion? For the third time, the Father said no. No. This time, the Father was not thinking about his son. The Father was thinking about you. The Father was thinking about me. The Father was thinking about us. And Jesus said, I get it. I get it. Not that you don't love me, because I know that you love me. But you love them. And I also love them. And he said, I will know.
After that prayer, he was arrested. He went to trial. He was flogged, he was scourged. He was asked to carry his cross. A crown of thorns was placed into his hand. He was nailed. He died. It was not for him. It was for us. It was for us. And that is why every time you see a cross, tell yourself, that's my Jesus. My Jesus died on that cross. So I can be saved. Because he was thinking about me. His Father was thinking about me. And that happened. And that is why, in one of the seven last words of Jesus Christ, this is the most moving part. When Jesus was hanging there, he said, Eloi, Eloi. And it was a cry. It was a cry. It was like, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. What's that? It's a strange prayer. Dad, Dad, why are you turning your back away from me? Why do you think? Father, Father, why did you turn your back away from me? The Father said, I can't live with you like that, son. I can't live with you like that. You're bleeding all over. You're suffering all over. You're carrying the sin of the people. And I can't afford it. I'm a dad. And I don't want to rescue you this time. I don't want to come and rescue you and get you off and pull you out of the cross. Otherwise, the people that we love will not be saved. That's a sacrifice. That's a prayer. Heavenly Father, what a sacrifice. You knew it even before you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to be born on earth. You knew it that he is going to suffer on the cross. You knew it. You knew everything that would happen to him. Every pain. Every cut on his skin, the nails, the blood, the humiliation. But you sent him anyway. When he asked you three times and you denied him three times, you were not thinking about him, you were thinking about it. And thank you. Jesus, you know the pain. You suffered. You went through it. So that we won't. You suffered through it so that we are not known to suffer. And the whole time that you were there hanging on the cross, the whole time you were being flogged and scourged, the whole ordeal, you were thinking about us. You were thinking about me. Just to give me a chance, just to give us a chance to have eternal life, to be forgiven of my sins. Thank you. As I close in prayer, anyone here, you said, as we keep on praying, anyone here, and you're telling yourself, my Savior, my Jesus suffered too much, and I don't want this to be in vain, I don't want this to be a nothing to be lost. And this time I want to make a decision to make him my Lord, to make him my Master, to make him my Savior, and to ask for his forgiveness, and by faith to claim the gift of eternal life so that when I die, going to go to his kingdom with him. And if you want to do that, again, don't let the cross pass by you without making a decision. Today is the right decision. If you are that person right now, God is talking to you, hey, this is not the time for you to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. Just follow the simple prayer. Jesus, you died for me. You sacrificed yourself for me. And I cannot thank you enough. Forgive me of my sins. I want you to be my Lord, to be my Savior. Forgive me of my sins. Wash away all of my sins in the past, a present, and in future. Wash it with your blood. The blood that was shed on the cross. And give me the gift of eternal life. Because when I die, when my time comes, I want to be with you forever. In your name.